I go to the library a lot. And I finished my last book at the library. I have Wi-Fi at home, but I also have 3 grandchildren that are 5 years old. And so I can't get any work done when I'm home. So I always go to the library and work. I finished my book, I went to the library and I said, you know, I really can't thank you enough for providing a quiet space with Wi-Fi. And so I gave her a donation. And she says, you don't have to do that, you pay your taxes. I said, well, I don't. And I support you. You know, so I get, and that's what I feel, that we support the things we use. Right?
Right?
You know, if we go to a park or if we drive, we support the roads and the bridges with gas taxes or tolls. And everything you buy has a tax in it. Right? So we're constantly paying taxes. We're constantly supporting the infrastructure. And things like libraries where, you know, I don't, then I like to donate. And then you all, a lot of you give what you would have given the government to people who are doing peace work or organizations who are doing peace work. You know, I figure since like 70% of my life is sacrificing for peace, that I'm my charity.
Yes,
I'm the charity that I give my money that I don't pay the government to, but I also donate to a lot of other places too. So, right now I'm on a bike ride. I don't know if, not right now. Obviously, I don't even have my bike. But I started on April 4th from Vacaville, California. And that's the day my son was killed in Iraq. We started at his grave. But it's also the day Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. So it was a very significant day in my family and in world history. And it's significant because the year before Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated, he was at Riverside Church in New York City saying the problems with the society are militarism, racism, and poverty. And that was in 1967. This is 2013. That was like 46 years ago. I was alive. I'm old. Wow. And so nothing's changed in those 40 years, except maybe some of that stuff has gotten worse. You know, racism is a hard topic for all of us white people to talk about. And then we have a person of color here. And the people who activate around 9/11, they say 9/11 is a day that changed America. Maybe for middle class white people, it was a day that changed America. You know, but I realized from the founding of this country, we've founded it on genocide. We founded it on forced black slavery. You know, so it's never been a country that we could support or a government that we could support. So we started from my son's grave. And we're biking to Washington, D.C. And first we went all the way down to California. California's a really long state, by the way. It's not too wide, but it's super duper long. And so we're going on Route 66, which is awesome. Have you guys ever been on Route 66? It's freaking awesome. And to cycle it instead of drive it, you know, it's just amazing to see the culture that has arisen around a road. And then they built the interstate. And if the interstate passed a town, that town died. That's the car culture.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just a very young culture. But you can see the decadence of that culture biking down Route 66. It's amazing to see old Model Ts rusting in a field. You know, all of the towns that still exist, it's always cool to have old cars. I don't know if they have engines, but they have old cars, and they're like painted nice. I went to Seligman, Arizona. I don't know if any of you have been there. There's a bunch of old cars from the 50s. And I told one of the waitresses, man, I feel like I'm in Cuba. You know, because if you've been to Cuba, you know, they all drive around old cars from the 50s. She looked at me like I was crazy again. You know? Maybe all these people telling me I'm crazy, maybe I should think. And so, so we're on 66 up to Chicago. Route 66 goes from Santa Monica, California, which we started at Arlington West, the Veterans for Peace anti-war memorial that honors people who have been killed in these wars, not just our troops, but everybody has been killed. And so Route 66 goes through California, Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Oklahoma, Missouri, Chicago, Illinois. And so sometimes it's not there. Sometimes it's just not there, so you have to get on the interstate and ride. But what I was going to say about that is that we're halfway on Route 66 already. My guys made the halfway point while I wasn't there today. So yay, it's been a month and we're halfway on 66. And so when we get to Chicago, we're going to just take various ways down to Washington, D.C. And biking across the country, I recommend it to everybody. If you haven't done it, I recommend that you get started right now. It's a good time of the year to start because it doesn't get too hot. But we're going to be in Washington, D.C. July 3rd, if any of you want to meet us there. We're going to have a convergence on the lighthouse. And I like to call Washington, D.C., my favorite little pet name for it is Washed Up D.C. And I don't like to spend that much time there because it's malignant.
Yes.
And so we're literally biking in, presenting a petition, and leaving. I have a flight home that night, you know, so, but because to us, it's not about the destination, it's about the journey. It's about meeting with people in these small towns and big towns, trying to convince them that not only is the empire a problem, but maybe we should look at our own lifestyles too, without judging people. You know, riding a bike is, you know, trying to tell people that our addiction to fossil fuels is killing life on this planet.
Yes.
Right? So, not just, we know that the military uses the most fossil fuel of any other, and it pollutes everywhere it goes, is a Superfund site. But we also have to take responsibility for the amount of fossil fuels that we use. And to try and wean ourselves away from that. You know, I work for peace. I'm known as a peace mom. But I think the issue of the environment has to be the number one issue. That has to be the number one issue that we address. And we can't just like have protests in D.C. and think it's going to be addressed. You know, we have to be on the ground everywhere addressing this issue. Everywhere they want to frack, everywhere they want to put in a pipeline, anywhere they want to drill offshore, whatever.
Nuclear power.
Coal, clean coal. You know, we have a president who supports all of these dirty energies. Right? So we're trying to go through the country talking about these issues. We're talking about the issues of war and peace. We're talking about the issues of the environment, sustainable energy. I'm really getting on the bandwagon about bike lanes and bike paths.
Thank you.
because I have driven over some really scary crap. And I've been on I-40 where the shoulder was this big. And there's no other way to go, you know, unless you walk your bike through, you know, the ground, you know, through the side or something. There's no other way you can get anywhere. And so they've made it so we have to be dependent on cars. We have to be dependent on fossil fuels. And so we're talking about these issues. Another one of our major issues, of course, is stop the prosecution of whistleblowers. But going with that is, why are you prosecuting people like Bradley Manning? And I don't even want to say prosecuting. I want to say persecuting. Why are you persecuting and torturing somebody like Bradley Manning and President Obama, his commander-in-chief, has already declared that he's guilty, which is a breach of command, right? He said, yeah, well, he's guilty. Somebody has it on tape, him saying that Bradley Manning is guilty. So he says Bradley Manning is guilty. His government is persecuting him. But then he flies down to Dallas to congratulate George Bush for being such a great leader after 9/11. You know, he should have been flying down to Dallas to slap handcuffs on them all, right? So we can't, I don't think we can ever have peace without accountability. And none of our war leaders have been held accountable for war. What was Nixon held accountable for?
Watergate.
Right. What was Clinton held accountable for? Not for wars, right? So accountability has to be something that we constantly don't. People say, Cindy, George Bush isn't president anymore. And I say, well, that's nice because my son's still dead. You know, and a couple million people are dead. He still needs to be held accountable, and everybody involved in that, everybody who profited off of all this death and destruction, they need to be held accountable. And you know why Obama won't do it? Because he's afraid the next president might hold him accountable.